Carl Benz was born on the 25th of November, 1844 in Karlsruhe. He later attended the Polytechnic University there, before gaining his first practical experiences at various mechanical engineering companies. He founded his own company in 1872, the Eisengießerei und Mechanische Werkstätte. However, it was not much of a success at first. It was only the dowry of Carl's wife, Bertha, that saved them from immediate ruin. In 1877, Benz started developing a two-stroke engine, and after 2 years, it ran sufficiently for the first time. The patent for a gas-fueled four-stroke cycle engine was already owned at that time by the Gasmotorenfabrik in Deutz. Nevertheless, Benz did patent some of his inventions, such as his engine speed regulator. A stock corporation under the name Gasmotorenfabrik Mannheim was set up in 1882. Carl Benz resigned from it a short time later, though. It was only the founding of the Benz & Company Rheinische Gasmotorenfabrik, together with the entrepreneurs Max Rose and Friedrich Wilhelm Esslinger, that led Benz to eventual success. The company, established in 1883, expanded quickly and was even able to grant licenses for the construction of gas-fueled engines. For Benz, it finally became possible to devote his time to the development of the car engine. Unlike Daimler, who integrated his engine into a carriage, Carl Benz was aiming for the development of an entire vehicle. In 1886, he was able to present his first Benz patent motor car to the public, a three-wheeled vehicle powered by a four-stroke gasoline engine. From 1885 to 87, three models with slight variations were produced. With the so-called Model 3, Bertha Benz undertook the first long-distance drive in the world in 1888. At a distance of 100 kilometers from Mannheim to Pforzheim, she experienced an adventurous drive. Without her husband, but with her sons. She only let him know after a happy arrival. In 1893, Carl Benz introduced axle pivot steering to car construction, followed 3 years later by the Contra engine, the ancestor of today's piston engine. The breakthrough for Benz & Company came in 1894 with the Velo. This light and budget-priced automobile was manufactured for 5 years. With a total production sum of about 1,200 units, it was the first mass-produced car in the history of the automobile. At the turn of the century, Benz & Company grew to be the leading manufacturer of automobiles in the world, with over 430 employees at the time. Carl Benz left the company 2 years later on account of discrepancies with the management. Together with his son Eugen, he established a new company in Ladenburg in 1906. Until the mid-20s, the Benz and Zerner cars were produced there. As taxis, they gained a certain degree of recognition, especially in England. As opposed to Gottlieb Daimler, who died 1900, it was granted to Carl Benz to witness the boom of motorization and the final breakthrough of his idea. Carl Benz, one of the fathers of the automobile, died in 1929 at his house in Ladenburg. Gottlieb Daimler was born on the 17th of March, 1834, in Schorndorf. From 1857 to 1859, the journeyman metalsmith attended the Polytechnic University in Stuttgart. Daimler became familiar with the four-stroke principle of the Otto motor during his time with the Gasmotorenfabrik Deutz, where he was employed as head of engineering until mid-1882. With his generous compensation, he bought a villa in Cannstatt, where he set up an experimental workshop in the garden. Feverishly, he worked on the development of a gasoline-driven motor, which was supposed to run all vehicles imaginable, on land, on water, and in the air. The first experimental motor emerged in collaboration with Wilhelm Maybach, who Daimler had already met many years ago in Reutlingen. In 1884, an improved version, dubbed the grandfather clock on account of its look, achieved 1 horsepower at 600 rotations per minute, considerably more than all former gasoline motors. After his first experiments with a two-wheeler, Daimler ordered a carriage from Hamburg in 1886. Under Maybach's instruction, a 1.5 horsepower engine, modeled after the grandfather clock, was installed. Using belts to relay its drive power, it became the world's first four-wheeled automobile and was completed secretly overnight. Exhilarated by the success of his motorized carriage, Daimler rented premises for production. Under the technical direction of Wilhelm Maybach, he employed 23 workers. As a mere experimental workshop, the factory was not sustainable for long, although the parallel production of boat motors did make profits. His last hope was collaboration with the powder manufacturer Max Dudenhofer and his friend Wilhelm Lorenz, which culminated in the foundation of a stock corporation in 1890. The Daimler Motorengesellschaft offered Maybach a contract for the position of technical director, but he refused. The conditions did not meet his expectations. Without Maybach, and more than ever after the exclusion of Gottlieb Daimler, the technical progress of the company stagnated, along with it, its success. Meanwhile, Maybach's Phoenix motor was causing a stir abroad. A group of English industrialists wanted to purchase the licensing rights. All previous efforts to get Maybach back to Stuttgart were failing on his condition that Gottlieb Daimler return to the company as well. The management finally had to give in, and so both founding fathers were aboard once again. This new constellation brought the Daimler Motor Corporation in 1895 to an unimagined boom. Maybach committed everything to make the company competitive again with new technical developments. But his old friend Gottlieb Daimler died only 5 years later, on the 6th of March, 1900, just before the first Mercedes entered production. With the invention of a fast-running engine and the automobile, Gottlieb Daimler and Carl Benz laid the foundation stone for individual motor car traffic. Both brought their own developments into the company, and both were looking for a catchy and unmistakable brand name. And that was how, at the turn of the century, the Daimler Motor Corporation caused furor with a completely new brand name, Mercedes. This Spanish name first belonged to Mercedes Jelinek, the daughter of Austrian business tycoon Emil Jelinek. Her sport-crazed father was especially enthusiastic about the automobile, and he was convinced that it would change the future with lasting effect. Being the best, and at times the only major customer of the young Daimler Motorengesellschaft, he demanded faster and more powerful vehicles every other year, presenting continuous challenges for the chief engineer, Wilhelm Maybach, and at the same time pushing progress forward. From 1899 on, Jelinek entered his vehicles in races, especially in the Nice Speed Week. The driver and his team were registered under a pseudonym, the name of his 10-year-old daughter, Mercedes. A fatal accident occurred in 1900 at the La Turbie Hill Climb, so Jelinek pressed for the production of a vehicle both faster and more lightweight. The newly developed sports and racing car with 35 horsepower was the first one to bear the name Mercedes. With its low center of gravity, pressed steel frame, and high-performance engine, it is regarded today as the first modern automobile. The Mercedes cars used at the Nice Week of 1901 turned out to be unbeatable in all categories. Vehicle and owner became the talk of the time. Paul Meillant, the Secretary General of the French Automobile Club, was deeply impressed by its success. In retrospect, he wrote of the race, "We were entering the era Mercedes." In March and April, the sister models 1216 horsepower and 811 horsepower were released. Jelinek's additional orders stretched the Konstadt Daimler plant to full potential. On the 23rd of June in 1902, the name Mercedes was entered as a trade name, followed by legal registration on the 26th of September. Emil Jelinek obtained permission to call himself Jelinek Mercedes from then on, commenting, "Probably for the first time, a father bears the name of his daughter." After the merger of the former competitors Benz and Daimler in 1924, the product range was initially modernized. An attractive but above all affordable vehicle was a major goal for competitive car sales programs in the 20s, which were conditioned by crises. A special importance, therefore, lay in the development of a new 2-liter model. Since 1923, the direction of the Central Engineering Office had been in the hands of Ferdinand Porsche. One of his inventions was the new 2-liter model, 838 horsepower. The first number stood for the cubic capacity related taxable horsepower. The second determined the actual engine performance. With the beginning of sales in autumn 1926, the startup model, internally called W02, was first available in three body variations: as open-top touring car and as saloon with either two or four doors. Model 838 was an immediate success. In 1927 alone, its production total was double that of all totals from the previous year by Mercedes, Benz, and Mercedes-Benz. In the course of changing type designation, 838 horsepower was renamed 838 Type 200 in February 1928. The improved model debuted in November 1928 at the Berlin Automobile Exhibition, where it caused quite a stir under the name Stuttgart 200. By the way, with certain extensions, the three figured numbers are still part of today's Mercedes-Benz nomenclature. The six-cylinder engine in the 828 had a high potential that parented numerous drive mechanisms over the next 12 years. One of those was the 1050 horsepower, type Stuttgart 260. Internally called W11, this new 2.6-liter car was supposed to close a gap in the sales program and thus meet demands for higher performance at the same price. All in all, 9,105 units of the 828 horsepower were produced. Type Stuttgart 200 was manufactured 6,452 times, and 6,757 units of the Stuttgart 260 were driven from the production plant. Numbers which proved the resounding success that the model ranges W02 and W11 had in their day. The Mercedes-Benz S-Types, internally known as W06, are counted among the outstanding sports cars of the Roaring Twenties. The S originally stood for sport and was followed by variations such as SS, meaning super sport, SSK, which denoted super sport version with short wheelbase, and SSKL, a lighter racing version of the former. Many of the wealthy gentleman owners drove their sporty Mercedes in both normal traffic and on the racetrack, with success. The first race, at the opening of the Nürburgring on June 19, 1927, ended with a triple victory of the S-Type. With the SSK, the well-known Rudolf Caracciola won the Klausenpassrennen in August 1930, and also became the European hill climbing champion. He had another outstanding triumph a year later with the lighter SSKL as the first foreign driver in the Mille Miglia, the still legendary 1,000-mile race in Italy. Incidentally, on account of their imposing appearance in the white racing paint, the S models were popularly known as white elephants. Not without reason. With an operational supercharger, the SSKL generated a stunning 300 horsepower and was able to reach what was for those days a breathtaking top speed, 235 kilometers per hour. While the design of the Type S emphasized suitability for racing, the SS was, from 1928, first and foremost, a Gran Turismo, which was underlined by the body type options. The legendary SSK was a child of the mountains, because short and agile vehicles were clearly advantaged on alpine racetracks. The wheelbase of the S model was shortened to 2,950 millimeters in 1928. For daily use, some customers had a convertible top attached to the existing chassis. 33 of those sporty two-seaters were produced between 1928 and 1932. The fourth and last model of the S range was designed solely as a competition vehicle. The lightweight SSKL was not part of the official sales program. Although only a small number were produced, it was the culmination of the legendary S range that shaped the sporty image of the Mercedes-Benz brand. The last cornerstone of the newly fashioned Mercedes-Benz car program, under the direction of Ferdinand Porsche, was the type Nürburg 460. The name recalled a test drive on the Nürburgring, where a type 460 was driven 20,000 kilometers in 13 days. This was the first mass-produced Mercedes with an 8-cylinder engine, and premiered at the Paris Auto Show in October 1928. R$15,000 was the handsome price of a Pullman limousine of the Nürburg type, which was already being revised in its second year. The previous high-frame chassis was replaced by a low frame, which gave the vehicle a more elegant appearance. Moreover, a variation with a shortened wheelbase was produced and designated with a K. This shorter chassis could accommodate a 4 to 5 seat passenger compartment. The regular Nürburg 460 with a standard wheelbase was available as an open top touring car or Pullman limousine, each sitting 6 to 7. From 1931 on, the Nürburg 460 was optionally supplied with overdrive or economy drive for an extra 2,000 Reichmarks. The add-on charge also included Zeiss headlights. Together with its 5-liter engine, this marked the birth of the later type, Nürburg 500. Visually, this model with its greater cubic capacity could not be differentiated from Model 460, the production of which was finally stopped in 1933. The successor was renamed Type 500, or 500N, and is recognizable by its slightly slanted windshield and V-shaped radiator. After a delivery total of 931 vehicles, the last 7 units of the Type 500 were produced in October 1939. Created for a circle of fortunate people who do not want to limit the fulfillment of their wishes. With this distinct advertising message of the early 30s, Mercedes-Benz targeted an elite clientele for the Type 770. The Grand Mercedes was literally a vehicle of superlatives. As the largest, heaviest, and most luxurious passenger car, it carried a price of over 40,000 Reichmarks, also making it one of the most expensive automobiles of its age. After 2 years of development time, the star model of the sales program was unveiled in autumn 1930 at the Paris Auto Show. Fighting for the rank of the leading German automobile, it was incidentally competing against Maybach's innovative Zeppelin 12-cylinder, which in the previous year had taken the pole position from the types Nürburgring and 630. The official English name of the 770 was Super Mercedes Straight 8. The mighty 8-cylinder inline unit generated 150 horsepower without supercharger and up to 200 horsepower with an optional supercharger. The huge driving mechanism enabled the limousines, which weighed up to 3.5 tons, a top speed of 160 kilometers per hour. Four giant ribbed brake drums accomplished deceleration, each equipped with a vacuum servo. Additionally, a three-gear transmission with optional overdrive offered a choice total of 6 gears, which in this luxury car were probably operated by a chauffeur. The Grand Mercedes was quick to find worldwide adoration. The Japanese imperial family alone ordered 6 between 1932 and 1935. Also in circles of industrialists and aristocrats, this new and exclusive product continuously gained popularity. All vehicles were hand-built and custom-tailored to individual wishes. The cabriolets B, C, D, and F, plus a 7-seat open touring car, completed the range of available chassis styles in September 1932. All variations wore the V-shaped radiator as a common trademark. With only 117 vehicles built, the 770 was, in regards to total production numbers, rather unimportant. And yet, the Grand Mercedes is beyond doubt as an integral part of the Mercedes-Benz myth. In February 1938, the series W07 was replaced by the W150 successor, a type called 770 Grand Mercedes, and of which 88 vehicles were built between 1938 and 1943. The Mercedes-Benz types in the 170 range were not quite as elegant and exclusive as their relatives in the luxury class, but they turned out to be real top sellers and epitomized the company's ability to grow with its tasks. The so-called Weimar Republic was suffering from the Great Depression. A new strategy was called for, and so a new vehicle type was launched in the beginning of the 30s. The Type 170, internally W15, was to secure the survival of the Daimler-Benz AG. Consequently, the aims were high. Smaller dimensions combined with high quality workmanship, affordably priced. In October 1931, the Mercedes-Benz Model 170 was introduced to the world at the Paris Auto Show. Its swing axles at the front and rear, dubbed independent wheel suspension, was a fairly advanced technical feature for the time. The plan worked. In 1932, already 4,438 vehicles had been sold, more than Mercedes-Benz production total in the previous year. Modern technology and the attractive shape of the car made it immensely popular. With a showroom price of 4,000 marks for a four-door sedan, the 170 was one of the most affordable cars in the sales program, in spite of its six-cylinder engine. Within 5 years, 13,775 units of the 170 were sold, plus an additional 126 of the delivery van version L300. In the spring of 1936, a successor was released, Type 170V of the 136 series. Apart from its cubic capacity, it was a completely new creation with a four-cylinder engine. The vehicle was developed under the direction of board member Dr. Hans Niebuhr, together with the engineer Max Wagner, who supplied it with an X-shaped oval tube frame with a higher wheelbase. It weighed about 50 kilograms less and was more robust than the previously used Type 170 box frame. At the time of the launch, an abundance of body variations already existed. The Type 170V was available as sedan with two or four doors, a cabriolet sedan, open touring car, cabriolet B, and a two-seat roadster. Like its predecessor, the chassis was offered with optional bodies and superstructural parts. In May 1936, the elegant cabriolet A followed as the most exclusive variation for 5,980 Reichmarks. Selling approximately 72,000 units, the 170V produced between 1936 and 1942 turned out to be the most important pre-war passenger car model by far. The V in the type name indicated a front engine. This distinguished it from Type 170 and its rear engine counterpart, Type 170H, which never really prevailed over the front engine variation. With only 1,507 produced, the 170H, internally called W28, was not a top seller in its day. However, today it is widely coveted by aficionados. The Mercedes-Benz Model 500K was a fascinating melange of sports car and exclusive luxury automobile. In March 1934, it was presented at the Berlin Automobile Exhibition as the successor of Model 380. It was supposed to attract a performance-oriented and demanding clientele. On the price list, the 500K for compressor started appearing with diverse body styles from June 1934 on. Available were a four-door sedan, dubbed interior steering at the time, a two-seat roadster with two emergency seats, the cabriolets A, B, and C, and a two-door open touring car. Every variation fetched a handsome 22,000 Reichmarks. The chassis alone tacked another 15,500 Reichmarks onto the bill. A veritable piece of eye candy, the Roadster was presented in Paris in October 1935. At 28,000 Reichmarks, it was the most expensive variation and still today is one of the most hounded of all automobiles. That those Mercedes models can only be owned by an elite, well-to-do clientele is no surprise. Movie stars, race drivers, and other celebrities turned the compressor Mercedes into a status symbol. The overdrive transmission with semi-automatic shifting epitomized the state of the art. The clutch was not needed for shifting from third gear into overdrive. Furthermore, in April 1936, the cubic capacity of the engine was expanded to 5.4 liters, raising the output to 115 horsepower, 180 with an additional supercharger. From September 1936 on, the designation was changed accordingly. Over the course of time, the former Type 540 with compressor was simply called 540K. All 1930s compressor types were made to order productions, tailored to individual wishes. The beauty and quality of the eight-cylinder car bodies drew admiration to the Sindelfingen facility for limited production. Of both W29 models, 761 chassis were produced between February 1934 and November 1939. 342 of these had a cubic capacity of 5 liters, another 419 of 5.4 liters. All stand among the great automobile legends and often command dizzying sums in collector circles. After the diesel engine successfully passed its practical test in 1924 in the world's first diesel truck, the Benz 5 tons, the production of a diesel passenger car, was within reach. The basic requirement was the pre-chamber principle invented by Prosper Lorange. In autumn 1933, the first experimental engines, 3.86 cylinders with an output of 80 horsepower, were installed into test vehicles of the Mannheim model. Nevertheless, the vibrations proved to be too strong for the chassis and therefore prevented their use in a passenger car. In 1935, under the direction of Chief Engineer Albert Hess, it was finally possible to install a 2.6 liter engine generating 45 horsepower into a lengthened chassis of the Model 200. Daimler-Benz displayed the result at the Berlin Motor Show. The Type 260D in the six-seated Pullman Lando Lay version. The first 13 vehicles had already been produced since July of the previous year. 260D was the world's first passenger car with a diesel engine. From September 1936, the 260D was on offer in additional body styles, such as the fixed-top Pullman sedan, 4-to-5-seat sedan, and the Cabriolet B seating 4 or 5. Due to the reliability of the CI engine, the 260D was predestined for commercial use as a taxi. At a top speed of almost 100 kilometers per hour, a full 10-liter fuel tank could go 400 to 500 kilometers. The 9,500 Reichsmarks price did not make the 260D a special offer, but the economic running costs quickly balanced the investment. Production of the 260D, internally W138, reached up to 1,967 by December 1940. The car proved the advantages of the diesel engine and thus marked the beginning of the diesel car's rise to success. During the war, most of the Daimler-Benz manufacturing plants were destroyed. Production afterwards resumed with the proven model 170V. Although at first, Americans only licensed repairing work on U.S. Army vehicles and the production of delivery vans, which were urgently needed for reconstruction. In May 1946, the first flatbed truck was produced, followed a month later by a delivery van. Ambulance and police cars extended the model range in autumn, and in July 1947, production of the four-door 170V sedan was resumed. In May 1949, the types 170D and 170S were presented, the first newly designed cars. The 170 was outstanding on account of its efficient 1.7 liter diesel engine, which even in those days burned clearly less fuel than its petrol-powered counterpart. The types 170V and 170D benefited from substantial makeovers in May 1950. To differentiate them from the originals, the improved versions were internally called 170VA and DA. Two years later, both models were modified again. Models 170VB and DB were fitted with widened rear axles, bumpers, and an enhanced windshield behind which the wiping mechanism was installed. Additionally, the louvres on the side of the hood were replaced by two horizontal strips. Production of the 170V and 170D continued until 1953. The continuing success of the model was mainly due to its efficient performance, reliability, and durability. As the new flagship of its car program in May 1949, Mercedes-Benz presented another spectacular vehicle, the Type 170S. In terms of style and engineering, it was based on the pre-war Type 230. But it differed from its predecessor, having a more powerful engine, an improved front axle, and a more spacious chassis. The range was extended with a two-seat Cabriolet A and a four-seat Cabriolet B. The Cabriolet A especially was regarded as a luxury vehicle and added class to the program. While undergoing substantial improvements in January 1952, the 170S was supplied with a steering column shift and a starter button, amongst other things. The variation was internally called 170B, and its prominent features included an enlarged rear window and internal trunk lid hinges. At the same time, the new Type 170DS was displayed. Equipped with a diesel engine of Type 170DA, it clearly exceeded the sales volume of the petrol-powered sister model. In 1953, the technically advanced follow-ups of the 170SV and the 170SD were introduced as an alternative to the latest design type, 180 Ponton, which was met with immense skepticism by the more traditionally minded customers. The last edition combined the largely unchanged chassis of the predecessors with the more spacious bodies of the 170SB and 170DS respectively. Here again, the diesel version was sold in higher volumes than the gasoline model. Hence, production of the 170SV ended in February 1955, whereas Type 170SD last came off the line in September of the same year. Along with the legendary Adenauer Mercedes, the Mercedes-Benz Type 220, internally W187, debuted at the first International Automobile Show in Frankfurt in 1951. In designing terms, the 220 was largely based on the 170S, and so chassis and body were nearly identical. But the headlights bestowed the vehicle with a brand new face, since they were now integrated into the front fenders. Compensating for the noticeably higher engine performance, the front wheels of the 220 were equipped with duplex drum brakes. An octane compensator made the engine suitable for different fuel qualities. The 220 was alternatively available as sedan. Elegant Cabriolet A, or four-seat Cabriolet B. The two-seat Cabriolet A was a genuine dream vehicle. The 18,000 Deutschmark price tag and a modest production volume of 1,278 proved its highly exclusive character. In December 1953, another body style was introduced. The new coupe quickly assumed the position of arguably the most exclusive version of Model 220. The basic charge was an exorbitant 20,850 Deutschmarks, plus a sunroof added another 1,150 marks to the bill. Technically and stylistically, the coupe was based on the Cabriolet A, and so both were equipped with new and improved 85 horsepower engines. Production of the 220 sedan finally ceased in 1954 after a total of 16,156 units. The last cabriolet had already left the Sindelfingen facilities a year before. Only coupes and the Cabriolet A were still manufactured up until August 1955. A magical moment for Mercedes-Benz came about in 1951, the unveiling of an automobile that wrote history. Type 300, internally W186, was the biggest and fastest series produced German car of its time. A refined sedan car of distinguished class, it quickly became the preferred vehicle of famous German statesmen. Outstanding personalities, like Federal Minister Ludwig Erhard, sat in its comfortable back seat. However, the myth revolving around the 300 goes back to the man who shaped the young Federal Republic like no one else, Konrad Adenauer. The first German chancellor just could not do without it, and even traveled abroad in his official car. No wonder the 300 is commonly known today as Adenauer Mercedes. Just like Type 220, the 300 was run by a six-cylinder engine with an overhead camshaft. The first version produced an output of 115 horsepower and reached what was then a stunning top speed of 160 kilometers per hour. The chassis frame design resembled those of types 170S and 220, but was adapted to suit the higher weight and striking performance of the 300. When heavy loads were carried, auxiliary torsion bars could be switched into action in the rear suspension to level the wheels, a completely novel feature of the Adenauer Mercedes, which was also available with a sunroof. Another option, the Cabriolet D with five or six seats. The first substantial improvements were carried out in 1954. The output of the new version, internally dubbed 300B, was raised to 125 horsepower. Brake shoes were enhanced and brake boosters added. What made the 300B distinguishable were front ventipanes, chrome fittings on the rear fenders, and overriders on both sides. A new modified Type 300 was released in 1955. The new version, internally called 300C, was discernible by its broadened rear window and the bigger tires. It was also provided with a single joint swing axle. As an extra, Mercedes-Benz offered an automatic transmission for the first time. In the summer of 1957, another thoroughly revised version was introduced. Technically and stylistically, the new 300 clearly differed from its predecessor. Its design designation, W189, separated the internally named 300D into an independent model range. The fuel in the engine was not atomized by a carburetor, but by direct fuel injection, which propelled the output of the 300D to 160 horsepower. By request, the new Adenauer Mercedes was available with servo steering, and starting from December 1958, even with air conditioning. Incidentally, for the first time in a Mercedes-Benz passenger car. First and foremost, the body was modernized, which became apparent with the broadened window areas. The range was complemented again with a Cabriolet D, with an added sum of 8,500 marks another exclusive variation with an impressive appearance up to this day.
Der Gewinner ist jeder Käufer eines Mercedes-Benz-Wagens, denn die gewonnenen Erfahrungen kommen ihm in allen Fahrzeugen, die den Mercedes-Benz-Stern tragen, zugute. Sie werden ehrlich überrascht sein und ebenso ausgeruht in die Konferenz kommen wie diese beiden Herren.